So good morning, everybody. It is a great pleasure for us today to have Antonio Agresti from the Department of Electronics Engineering from the University of Rome, Tor Vergata in Italy. It is a great pleasure to have him here today with us. Antonio will tell us about 2D materials in tandem perovskite silicon photovoltaic technology. Antonio is working on perovskite solar cells, organic photovoltaics, and other interesting problems. We are really glad to have him here today with us. So please go ahead with your talk, Antonio.
Okay, so thanks a lot for the invitation and for the kind introduction. And as you mentioned today, we will the focus of our talk will be the photovoltaics, but in particular a peculiar marriage between bidimensional material and a new emerging photovoltaic technology based on perovskite silicon tandem solar cell. Almost all the results that I will present in this talk are arising from the Graphene Flagship project, a huge project started 10 years ago, in which a lot of partners are involved. And one of the partners of this project is the Hellenic Mediterranean University from Crete, that is strongly collaborating with our research center, the CHOSE, Center for Hybrid and Organic Solar Energy here at the University of Rome, Tor Vergata. So all the results that I will present are, of course, the results stemming from this huge collaboration. Okay, let's move on. So when speaking about the photovoltaics, of course, we noticed that in the market there are a huge possibility to choose a photovoltaic technology. Why we need a so a huge amount of possibility? First of all, depending on the application. So there is, of course, the choice of a PV technology is different if we want to focus on a massive production and thus for example, PV field, or distribute the production as on the home rooftop, or for example, when we want to power consumer electronics. So we can imagine to integrate photovoltaics or flexible devices, for example, in a backpack as represented here, or in object that can be used in the common life. Moreover, when choosing a photovoltaic technology, we need to focus the attention even on the efficiency. That's why almost all the technology, the PV technology present on the market, have now been divided in three classes. The first one is based on silicon and is showing the best efficiency in terms of power conversion efficiency. The second generation technology is based on thin film, promising low fabrication cost. And the third generation aim to merge both the advantages of the first and the second generation, low fabrication cost, but retaining high efficiency. Speaking about the cost, another way to evaluate the cost of a technology is the energy payback period. Is the time period in which you can produce with your photovoltaic field an energy equal to the energy employed for producing your PV technology. And of course, the lower is this energy payback period, the higher will be the efficiency even in terms of cost of your PV equipment. And by comparing the main PV technology on the market, we we can see that the emerging perovskite solar cell technology is really promising in terms of a very short energy payback period, because the fabrication cost is really low if compared to the technology already present on the market. So by comparing all the photovoltaic technology in terms of efficiency, here this is the best research cell efficiency plot following the efficiency trend of all the proposed photovoltaic technology on the market. In particular, we can observe that in the upper part of the picture, the inorganic-based technologies are the most efficient one, while especially in the last 20 years, some new emerging technologies based on hybrid or organic material were developed by scientists, by the research, and by new companies, till demonstrating efficiency approaching 20%, so comparable with at least the polycrystalline silicon technology. And in this scenario, the perovskite solar cell emerged in the last 15 years with an astonishing increase in terms of power conversion efficiency, till reaching in 2023 more than 25% of efficiency approaching 26%. So why perovskite solar cell technology is so promising? In particular, the perovskite is the name of the molecules, or better, of a class of a chemical compound with a peculiar crystalline structure that is here represented. So this peculiar crystalline structure is formed by several octahedra surrounding a big organic or even not organic cation. In the co most common perovskite called methyl ammonium lead iodide perovskite, this big cation is an organic one, is represented by the methyl ammonium ion. Then other main character are the lead atoms, in particular are the lead atoms, in particular positioned at the center of this octahedral, and finally the halogen. Halogen can be, of course, iodine, but as we will see in the next slide, we can combine several organic or inorganic cation, and we can play with both metal and halogen atom in order to achieve new perovskite formulation. Why perovskite is a so good absorber material? First of all, for its direct band gap, it means that the bottom of the valence band, the bottom of the conduction band, is in the same position looking at the Brillouin zone of the crystalline lattice with respect to the top of the valence band, and this allows a very efficient optical transition in the material and thus a very efficient absorption of the sunlight in a huge range from 300 to more or less 750-760nanometer. Moreover, the perovskite is a very good hole and electron conductor due to the very high diffusion length of both electron and hole charge. And moreover, one of the main aspects in which especially companies are interested in is the possibility to deposit the perovskite absorber by means of solution-based processes, and thus by means of a printing technique that are lowering a lot the production cost using just the standard printing machine, not so costly as such as, for example, the high vacuum processes or the other equipment present in the clean room for the fabrication of silicon-based devices. Moreover, the perovskite is very versatile in terms of tunability, band gap tunability. Indeed, we can change the band gap and thus the wavelength range in which the absorber can absorb the visible radiation by simply changing, for example, by simply mixing different metal atom, for example, different halogen, sorry, for example, chlorine with the bromine with the iodine, and changing the content of bromine, we can increase or decrease the energy band gap of the perovskite. But the same effect is obtained by changing the organic and the inorganic cation. Here I reported just the most famously used, the methyl ammonium, the cesium, and the formamidinium. So we can see in literature, of course, a lot of perovskite recipe with multi-cation or multi-halogen composition. So how does a perovskite solar cell is working? First of all, the substrate on which the perovskite solar cell is built is a conductive glass, so a glass with a fluorinated tin oxide. Then we have a compact Tiu2 layer and a mesoporous Tiu2 layer, and this layer is acting as an electron transporting layer in the structure, since the conduction will be given from the movement of both electron and all charge once created within the perovskite solar cell structure. Then we have the perovskite absorber with its peculiar and special properties. And finally, we need a whole transporting material for collecting the positive charge, thus the holes. Usually in this mesoscopic structure, the spirometad is the small molecules, the organic small molecules used as a whole transporting material, but as we will see in literature, there will be a huge possibility to change both electron, whole transporting material, and even the structure of the perovskite solar cell. And finally, a counter electrode that could be opaque or for semi-transparent or tandem device, even semi-transparent. In the case of a semi-transparent counter electrode, the gold can be replaced by, for example, a sputtered indium methine oxide. That is a conductive oxide. So when the perovskite is absorbing the radiation, an electron hole pair is formed in the perovskite material and is immediately severed. So in this way, electron and holes can travel toward the external circuit and produce the electric work outside the device. The results is the typical current voltage characteristics with the typical parameter of field factor, open circuit voltage, and short circuit current, and the product between the field factor, short circuit current, and open circuit voltage will give rise to the final power conversion efficiency of our device indicated with eta. And here, for example, here I reported just as example one of the record in the NRL best efficiency research picture that we observed before, and just to underline that a perovskite solar cell can produce an open circuit voltage exceeding 1.17 volt with a field factor exceeding 80% and a power conversion efficiency exceeding 25%. Of course, all these records were reported on small area devices. So what about the technology on which we want to speak today? So the perovskite silicon tandem technology. We're speaking about a tandem device. We are speaking about a device composed by two or more solar cells stacked on top of each other. Thus, the top cell is demanded to absorb the part of the radiation, and the rest of the radiation that has been not absorbed by the top device is absorbed by the bottom device, in our case, the silicon one. Indeed, the perovskite and silicon combination is a very powerful combination in terms of In terms of the absorbance of the in terms of the absorption of the radiation, since as you can see in this picture on the right, the external quantum efficiency and thus the current that we can produce with the perovskite is complementary with the current that can produce in terms of wavelength and thus in terms of absorption range the filtered silicon. The filtered silicon. In particular, perovskite can absorb in the visible radiation, while silicon is peculiarly efficient in absorbing the near infrared and infrared radiation till 1100 nanometer as wavelength, and thus depending, of course, on the band gap of both perovskite and silicon that we want to use for making this tandem device. So why, what about the efficiency? Recently in the last 10 years, a lot of efforts were devoted to develop such perovskite silicon technologies. On one side, because of course silicon perovskite has not the aim to replace silicon that is already developed, and a lot of companies have already the equipment for developing the silicon technology. And from the other end, thanks to the very astonishing efficiency demonstrated by this technology, indeed, over small area devices, so we are speaking about an area of around 0.1 centimeter square, recently in this year, KAUST was able to demonstrate more than 33.2% of efficiency. So why tandem technology at a certain point, since we have a lot of PV technology? Because each PV technology is limited in terms of efficiency by a theoretical limit that is called the Schottky-Quessier limit. And in particular for the silicon, this efficiency limit that is still not reached is around 29%. So how we can move further? We can join, as we mentioned, to more than one solar cell absorbing in a different range. And the first attempt was done by means of the 3-5 multi-junction that are very, very efficient, so showing efficiency above 35%, but are really costly. Indeed, this technology is used for space application. So one of the possibilities to join the new perovskite technology promising low cost and high efficiency with the already well-developed silicon one. Of course, we have some limit why nowadays perovskite silicon technology is still not on the market, mainly related to the perovskite, of course. Of course, we need to demonstrate the scalability of the technology and the maintaining of the efficiency from going from a small area to large area devices, but even we need to solve some problem when coupling perovskite with silicon or when directly growing a perovskite solar cell on top of the already developed silicon technology. Indeed, the producer of silicon are not so prone to change the production process for hosting the perovskite solar cell technology on top. So we need to propose a technology, a way to integrate the top cell in even convenient for the companies producing the silicon devices. So what are the main structure for the main possibility to connect a perovskite and silicon tandem device? The first possibility is the so-called four terminal connection. In this connection, perovskite is architecture, perovskite and silicon solar cell are treated separately, so are separately realized, and thus no process compatibility is required because silicon and perovskite are realized in a separate way, in a separate production line. And once at the end, they were stacked on top of each other. But in this case, of course, since these solar cells are working as independent devices, they need even an independent electronics that are extracting the maximum power from both top and bottom devices. So in this case, the tandem technology is promising, of course, higher efficiency than the single composing technologies by simply stacking one on top of each other. In the case of, but of course, this structure is more or less limited by the cost, because we need to double the electronics for managing the power production of both the technologies. In the case of the two terminal connection, indeed, the perovskite solar cell is directly grouped on top of the silicon one. We have several advantages, of course, the simple structure, the higher potential efficiency, because we are removing some connection and thus some contact in between between the silicon and perovskite, and we can achieve it as a high voltage. But of course, we have some cons that are not so easy to be overcome. In particular, the process compatibility in this case is required. For example, the mesoporous TiO2 sponge that we saw as an electron transporting layer in the perovskite is usually realized by sintering the perovskite solar cell at 480 degrees. And this temperature is not compatible with the silicon. So silicon cannot survive to this temperature. So we need to adapt the perovskite solar cell production processes for following addressing the constraint of the silicon technology. And moreover, we are limited by the current matching condition. So since these two solar cells are series connected, just a unique current will flow through these devices. So of course, the main current will be limited by lowest current flowing in one of the two solar cells. So what we can propose to overcome these two strategies? We can propose a two terminal mechanically stacked device. So we can realize, as in the case of a four terminal devices, we can realize the two devices in a separate pilot line by merging only at the end the two technologies. So we don't have anymore the requirement on process compatibility. The structure is still simple, and we are not requiring any modification to the silicon company for producing their solar cell, because we can use directly already made solar cell, silicon solar cell, even with the connection bus bar, the collection, sorry, bus bar. And we can simply stack by reversing the perovskite solar cell, the perovskite solar cell on top of the silicon. Of course, perovskite solar cell should be semi-transparent, should be developed in a way in which we can maximize the absorption of the power production of the entire structure. In this case, the only constraint that is still remaining is the current matching, since the cells are connected together, but we have the advantage of the two terminal structure in which we have just one electronic managing system, and thus reduce the production cost as like to the company, to the PV company. So, of course, in order to propose this technology, we have some issues to be solved. Perovskite silicon technology should demonstrate high efficiency even on scalable device structure, and thus we need at the very end to cover a silicon buffer that is more or less 200 centimeters square as active area size. And moreover, we need to still solve stability issues stemming from the perovskite part when working under outdoor condition. So in order to do that, we are proposing in our work the use of the bidimensional material. Bidimensional material was discovered for the first time by the two Nobel Prize Novoselov and Game in 2004, and they were awarded by the with the Nobel Prize in Physics in 2010 for the discovery of graphene and for the development of the and for the discovery of the peculiar properties of graphene that were only theorized till this discovery. So a bidimensional material is a material with a very reduced thickness, in the best case just one atomic layer, and thus due to this very reduced third dimension, the physics ruling that this third dimension is the quantum mechanics, and thus from here the special properties of this 2D material, such as for example the extreme robustness but even the flexibility, or as in and thus even exceptional properties in terms of electronic conductivity, but even for example some special properties in terms of energy band alignment, such as for example in graphene that show the pure graphene zero band gap. So and a band gap that is very easy to be tuned, and in this case, in the case of graphene, it's even easy to dope in the case of n-type material, or in order to obtain n-type material or p-type material depending on the application. Of course, bidimensional material is not only graphene, but there are a lot of family of bidimensional material. We cannot describe all this family in detail, but I want to mention, for example, maxines, xenes, or transition metal chalcogenates in this scenario. That we can use for modifying our perovskite solar cell structure in order to solve some problem from the scalability to the problem related to the interface. Indeed, since our perovskite solar cell is a sandwiched device, interface play a crucial role in the device performance and stability, because it is the interface that the charge transfer occur, and in particular this interface have a peculiar role in the band alignment in terms of material. Indeed, we need to avoid at the interface interfacial vacancies, the effect due to the poor adhesion or energy barrier for the charge transfer and collection at the electrode. So we can play with the bidimensional material with a technique that is called interface engineering. And how we can do that? We can insert bidimensional material, for example, as interfacial layer between at the interface, or we can directly insert bidimensional material within the precursor solution composing the perovskite solar cell before to deposit the each perovskite solar cell layer in order to tune the optoelectronic properties of the interface, and thus aiming to improve both the power conversion efficiency, device stability, but even helping the scalability of the device. So in our, I will show you just some example stemming from our work in the context of the graphene flagship, and thus, for example, the use of the graphene within the electron transporting layer, and the doping of the perovskite with the maxines, and finally the use of a peculiar bidimensional material that is a bidimensional perovskite in a way due to a peculiar way in fabricating this additional perovskite that has a 2D-dimensional characteristics atop the 3D-dimensional perovskite. So these are the results of our work in tuning the interface by means of a bidimensional material. When inserting, for example, graphene into the compact at IU2, we can improve a lot the electron extraction, reducing the dark current in the device. When introducing graphene into the mesoporus, we demonstrate an improved perovskite crystal growing, and this is a very effective and powerful role of this technique due to the fact that We can control the crystallization even on large substrate, and thus this is helping us a lot in scaling up the device dimension. And of course, we can easily transfer by means of the graphene presence within the mesoporous TiO2 the electron from the perovskite to the photoelectrode. Regarding the 2D perovskite interlayer, what is the role? It acts as a passivator for the reduction of the charge recombination at such interface, at the interfaces between perovskite and the ultrasparting material, and is reflected in an improved open circuit voltage. And finally, it favors the transfer of the hole toward the electron transporting layer by providing even as a protection for from the moisture, and thus by increasing a lot of the stability of the final devices. What about the Maxine in perovskite absorber? First of all, Maxines are a bidimensional material obtained by the exfoliation of a 3D phases that is called the Max phase. In particular, Maxines has this structure, so MXT, where M represents a transition metal, X a carbon or nitrogen atoms, and X a standard determination, OH or oxygen or fluorine. And by changing this determination, we can change the work function of a Maxine in a very broad range, from 1.6 electron volt to 6.25 electron volt. So why this is useful? Because if you mix Maxines with the perovskite, you cannot obtain a change in terms of morphology of your perovskite layer, but you can obtain a change in terms of the work function. So the work function of Maxines is changing the work function of perovskite, and changing the work function of perovskite means change the perovskite alignment within the energy band diagram. So this is due to a peculiar dipole that is forming at the interface between perovskite and Maxine. I will not go into too much in detail. This is a work published in Nature Energy. If you are interested, I reported here the reference. And this is a powerful approach, because by tuning the perovskite work function without changing its morphology and its optoelectronic properties, let's say, we can of course adapt all the electron transporting layer or all transporting material present in literature by making a very efficient device. So how we can merge these strategies, the strategies of a bidimensional material within the perovskite silicon technology. If we consider as a bottom cell a silicon heterojunction, as here represented, provided by the Enel Green Power Company here in Italy, we can insert in our mesoscopic perovskite solar cell both graphene in compact and mesoporous layer and Maxines by pushing the final efficiency of the perovskite silicon tandem cell above 27%. And if we insert even the 2D perovskite strategies, we were able to demonstrate more than 28%, approaching 29% in terms of efficiency. This is, of course, not the record of the perovskite tandem technologies, but it is. But what we are proposing is a very simple integration strategy. So, by producing the perovskite in a different pilot line with respect to the pilot line of the silicon, and just at the end coupling the devices without requiring energy, any modification in the silicon pilot line production. Of course, we need to scale up this technology to the buffer size, because the technology now used in the silicon industry is a M2 technology, so 15.7 times 15.7 centimeters square. There are a lot of advantages in using this silicon heterojunction bottom cell. One of these advantages is the higher performance and is the thickness, the reduced thickness, and thus the reduced cost for the fabrication of this new technology. So in order to further push the efficiency, we can adapt, we can modify, as we mentioned, the band gap of our perovskite solar cell by matching the current of the silicon produced by the filtered silicon. This can be, and the optimal band gap has been calculated to be around 1.7 electron volt, and this can be achieved by tuning the ratio between iodine and bromine, as we saw in the perovskite chemical structure. But this is not, if on one side this is easy to do from the chemical point of view, this can induce a reduction in the perovskite solar cell lifetime, since the higher is the bromine content, the lower will be the lifetime of the perovskite absorber, since bromine is segregating and thus inducing perovskite film degradation. So how we can adapt the current of the perovskite solar cell with the dose produced by the silicon technology. I didn't mention that the silicon cell chosen for this application is a bifacial cell, so is able to collect the radiation even the radiation reflected from the ground, so the albedo radiation, what is called as albedo. And in this case, what we can do is avoid to tune the perovskite band gap, and we can tune the albedo radiation for obtaining at the very end a current matching between the current produced by the perovskite that is higher than the perovskite than the current produced by the silicon devices. So if we want to push up this current produced by silicon, we can just modulate the albedo radiation absorbed by the silicon solar cell, and this part of the radiation is only absorbed by the silicon solar cell. Thus, we can just tune the silicon solar cell, the silicon current up by matching at the very end the current of the perovskite. Then, if you are able to absorb more radiation with perovskite, we can even further push up this match the current. And with these strategies and with our standard perovskite, we can, without any chemical modification, we were able to demonstrate efficiency above 29%, but theoretically are estimated to this configuration is estimated to achieve more than 32.2% of efficiency. So how many time I have just to conclude?
Roughly 15 minutes.
Okay, 15 minutes, perfect. So now, of course, we demonstrate all this record and this work based on bidimensional material on small data devices. But one of the main challenges is to scale up the technology and to cover finally the buffer scale. So the problem is a problem related to the perovskite technology, how we can scale up the perovskite technology. First of all, we cannot image to simply enlarge the cell, because if we are simply enlarging the cell due to the resistivity of the transparent conductive oxide, our device is undergoing a huge drop in terms of open circuit voltage, even higher than the open circuit voltage produced by the same devices. So we need to change the layout of the cell, and we need to move from a large area cell to a large area modules. So to realize a n stripe shaped small cell, and finally connecting this solar cell in stripe. In this way, the resistivity that our current is seeing in our root is the resistivity of the FTO of the conductive oxide, but just for one stripe, so with a reduced length. And in this case, thus, the final voltage drop is the voltage drop that we can get with a very large, unique large devices, but divided the number of the cell. So theoretically, if you increase a lot the number of the cell, you can reduce a lot this voltage dropping, and thus we can scale up our device all over the dimension of our substrate. Of course, take in mind that the insertion of a vertical interconnection can cause, again, can insert a resistive path for the current, and thus we need to limit the number of the cell in order to limit the number of the vertical interconnection, and thus is a trade-off between the dimension of the modules, the number and the number of the cell, and the width of the cell. Bidimensional material still remain a very advantage strategy for to be inserted in the larger devices, since it can be produced by means of a liquid phase exfoliation in a very huge amount and directly in the form of ink. In this case, we can mix the ink of bidimensional material with the perovskite precursor ink, usually used for covering a large area by means of some large area printing technique and chip technique, such as, for example, slot die or blade coating, spray coating, and thus we can simply dope the bidimensional the precursor of the perovskite solar cell layer with the bidimensional material, or use them as interlayer deposited by the same printing technique. So these are just an example of the scaling up. If we include, if we start from a 100 centimeter square module without any bidimensional material, and if we insert graphene in the electron transporting layer, maxins in the perovskite, and a transition metal dichalcogenate based on molybdenum disulfide as interlayer between perovskite and spirometal, we were able to demonstrate to retain high efficiency over a large area device, so more than 70% efficiency over 121 centimeter square. And if we still increase the module till 200 centimeter square, we were able to demonstrate approaching 15% of efficiency. Why we need 200 centimeter square? Because we need to cover a silicon buffer size. Okay, this is true, and this can be used for forming a panel. So each bidimensional modified perovskite module can be used for making a panel. So if you, for example, connect 40 realized module 11 by 11 centimeter square, by realizing you can realize a panel. Then if you realize more than 40 modules, we can realize finally more than one panel. This panel of about 0.5 meter square were measured here in Tor Vergata and then sent in Crete with a maximum power efficiency on panel above 10%, so comparable with the existing technology panel, existing PV technology. And then we sent this panel to Heraklion, so to the Hellenic Mediterranean University, to the group of Professor Kimakis of Kostas Rogedakis, that assembled this panel in a 4.5 meter square solar farm, powering the facilities of the HMU lab. Moreover, they monitored this perovskite solar farm along the year for more than 9 months by retaining more than 80% of the initial efficiency, and estimating a total production in 9 months of about 372 kilowatt per kilowatt hour. So now, finally, what is the final challenge is to, of course, realize the tandem panel. So we demonstrated the scaling up of perovskite, even thanks to the use of a bidimensional material. We demonstrate this possibility to use to directly put our top cell on top of the silicon bottom panel. So what are now the strategy for developing perovskite silicon panel? For terminal technology is still, so we need to put a module on top of a silicon cell. Of course, for terminal technology still have the high system cost and, but moreover, even the dependence toward the operating condition, toward the operating condition, because different technology are suffering different conditions. So depending on the operation condition outside. So what we can propose in order to reduce the cost of the panel is to employ a two-terminal voltage match configuration. In this case, we are directly putting the connected perovskite module atop the connected cell module. Silicon cell in a panel configuration. And if we are able to guarantee a voltage matching condition, we can directly electrically connect the top and the bottom panel by having a final two terminal voltage match connection. And in this case, we have a reduction of the cost. Indeed, only one MPP tracker, for example, an inverter is required. And we can gain an advantage from the already demonstrated scalability of both the technologies. So, first of all, we need to cover one commercially available silicon buffer size. We need to design a panel layout able to guarantee the final voltage matching condition. How we can answer to this question? First of all, we need to take into account that we are moving from a opaque device, the standard demonstrated large area perovskite modules to a semi-transparent, and the resistivity of gold is not the same of the resistivity of a sputtered indium tin oxide on top of the perovskite solar cell in order to realize the semi-transparent electrode. Thus, we need to we cannot extend the dimension of the module till the buffer size, but we can be clever by connecting in parallel more than one mini modules in perovskite. So with as a trade-off between the dimension and the final efficiency of the semi-transparent modules, we can cover one buffer size the silicon solar cell with four mini modules. In this case, if we optimize the layout with a 20 the layout of the perovskite solar cell with 20 solar cell, each perovskite mini module will deliver at the very end 22 volt as open circuit voltage. In order to achieve this 22 volt with the silicon bottom panel, we need to connect 32 silicon solar cell in series. So with a final panel that is composed by 32 silicon cell. And thus we need to cover 32 silicon solar cell and thus 128 perovskite mini module should be connected in parallel. Once will be able to produce so many modules, but we already demonstrated that this huge production in our research center in the realization of the solar of the perovskite solar farm, we can finally stack these perovskite based top panel based on two-dimensional material atop the silicon based bottom panel, and finally simply electrically connected in an external way, realizing the 2D material based perovskite silicon tandem panel. So this is what we are proposing now in the last phase of our graphene flagship project. So this device should be already realized, should be realized in the next months. At the moment, we already realized the first building block by laminating four perovskite mini module atop a silicon buffer sized produced by the Enel Green Power company. And we already sent this object to the HMU group for testing it outdoor. So now the production is incoming, and if you will be happy, I will update you in a future talk about this work. And thus giving some take-home message from this talk. So we proposed the perovskite material as a new PV solution for the optoelectronics. Then we can scale up this perovskite till a module size of 200 centimeters square without losing too much in efficiency and being competitive with the already existing technologies. And bidimensional material can help in stability in the demonstrating the stability and in the scalability of this technology. Moreover, regarding the perovskite silicon technology, it is really possible to overcome 30% efficiency, but it is really possible even to scale up the technology in a tandem panel. Here we propose a two terminal voltage matched configuration in order to avoid to directly realize the perovskite solar cell atop the silicon buffer, and in order to avoid to ask to the company to change their production line or to install a new production line for the perovskite, integrating it in the silicon production line. But of course, other solution can be found, and if a company are able to convert a little bit and to change a little bit the production process, we can even imagine to directly realize that the perovskite atop the silicon textured solar cell by means of other deposition technique for the perovskite solar cell, such as, for example, the high vacuum evaporation. So I want to thank, of course, all the Graphene Flagship for the foundings, the teams in which I belonging. Thanks to my professor Aldo Di Carlo that was setting all the facilities, the project, and the money for this this work. All the collaborators in this work, even the Hellenic Mediterranean University, and of course all of you for your kind attention.
Well, thank you. Great talk. Thanks a lot. Very interesting stuff. And also, it's very pleasant for us to hear that there is such a strong collaboration between Rome and Crete.
Yeah. Yes. Of course.
Yeah.
It's a long time collaboration. 10 years at least.
Very good. Maybe you should stop sharing your screen so that you can see each other. Thanks a lot. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. So, any questions, comments?
I can give an overall with Antonio.
Hello, Manos. Hi.
Antonio and his team, maybe Sarah, they have done a huge work. They have fabricated by themselves 400 modules. So, some people in Europe cannot do one single module, and they did 400. So this was a huge, achievement. That's why we published Nature Energy. Okay, we did some part as well here because we measured all the outdoor measurements, but without them, we couldn't do it. So this is what about collaboration means. Everybody unites forces. So Antonio, well done and keep the good work. We're waiting to do the same for the tandem now.
Yeah. We are doing our best. You will receive soon some demonstrator.
I must confess, I was not aware of this collaboration, but this is apparently very fruitful. Let me ask you, if you don't mind, a couple of trivial questions, but I apologize. I'm not an expert on this field. First of all, I understand that there is, you mentioned that there is an upper bound for the efficiency of around 30%. But if you go to multi-junction solar cells, this may exceed this upper bound. Yes. Could you tell us a bit more? I mean, are these strict bounds, or are they just, from our experience, are there any real physical mechanisms which you know do not allow these systems to give us more energy than you know nature allows them to do.
Yes, of course. Now it's an interesting question. Thanks a lot. Is of course the upper limit, the theoretical upper limit, is determined by the absorption, the complete absorption of all the wavelength region provided by the sun. Okay, so if we are able to build a solar cell that is able to convert in a very efficient way all the radiation, so by, for example, stacking more than two or three solar cells, of course, this can improve a lot the efficiency. Indeed, multi-junction based on 3-5 material already demonstrated more than 40% in efficiency. So it depends a lot on the absorber that you could, and on the absorber and on the compatibility between the composing the technology for the tandem device that you are developing. In the case of a perovskite solar cell, we have a huge possibility to form tandem devices with the perovskite, not only with silicon. Silicon, of course, is one of the most appealing combination because the industry of photovoltaics is now based on silicon, at least those that we can see on the market. But of course, there is a lot of efforts in developing, for example, CIGS, perovskite tandem, or in still in the field of the research, perovskite tandem, or even multi-junction perovskite devices. So by growing on top of each other more than one perovskite, more than two perovskite solar cell with a different band gap, thanks to the tunability in terms of chemistry of the band gap of the perovskite. So you can imagine that by changing the recipe of the perovskite, the composition of the perovskite, you can absorb in different wavelength range, and putting on top of each other this solar cell, you can extend a lot the absorption range even of the same perovskite technology. Of course, then you need to face with a lot of technological problem. For example, as I mentioned, the compatibility, the process compatibility, if you want to directly put the perovskite top cell on atop the silicon or atop the technology that you are choosing, or for example, if you want to realize the perovskite atop perovskite, since perovskite is a solvent-based technology, there are a lot of solvent problem compatibility in putting one layer atop of the other. So of course, there are a lot of challenges, and that's why there is a huge effort in terms of the scientific community in developing such new technology.
So apart from the cost and technical difficulties, an ideal, say, photovoltaic cell, could it have an 100% efficiency? I mean, is that
No, 100% efficiency. No, from the fundamental knowledge, no, because you should consider other effects, such as, for example, the presence of the recombination, of the charge recombination within the material, the drop in the charge collection that you have by in a multi-layered devices, for example, the fill factor that cannot be, of course, 100% as an ideal IV curve, but can be only it can be above 80%, but is still a good fill factor above 80%. So there is a theoretical limitation in dependence of course, the energy band gap, and for multi-junction independence of this in the electronics, in the physics of the device that cannot overcome.
Okay, thanks a lot. Any other questions?
Something?
Yes, please, go ahead.
Hi, Antonio. I'm George.
Hi, George. Ciao.
I know from the first hand your good work in perovskite solar panels, and I would like to ask you if you have in mind the tandem silicon with perovskite about the bifacial tandem. We have in outdoor measurements here that morning and afternoon we have some discontinuous in the IV curves. So we'd like to know the voltage and current mismatching in bifacial. Is the same when you try to do the same thing in one fascial, or we have to do something else to measure the bifacial voltage mismatching and current mismatching?
Okay. Thanks a lot for the question. No, I think that the bifaciality should not be a huge problem in terms of the voltage matching, since the voltage is logarithmically dependent on the irradiance. So what we are pushing a lot is the current and not the voltage. And since the current of the top panel and the current of the bottom panel is the sum, at the very end, we should not experience this huge, let's say, mismatch between, at least in terms of voltage. Let's see. I'm curious. Let's see from your measurement if you are even able to measure the albedo radiation, how much is the albedo radiation that we are sending to our semi-transparent panel. In our idea is to send to you mini panel, both semi-transparent, let's say totally semi-transparent, so enabling the absorption of albedo radiation, and even opaque from one side, so not able to collect the albedo radiation. So in this case, we can compare these two technology, and we effectively understand what is the role of this bifaciality that is typical of the NL silicon technology, but not typical for other silicon based technology.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Well, okay, then I think we should stop this.
Again, thanks a lot.
Yeah, it was wonderful to have you with us. And I hope this collaboration will continue.
I hope so.
We'll see you in September in the conference. Eh?
Yeah. The And then we need to organize even the meeting, the final meeting together with Enel. So let's
do that. Okay.
Let's discuss between me, you, Constance. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, Antonio, very much. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, George, as well.
Bye.
Bye, George. Bye.
Thank you.